Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Chow Ragsdale, and along with my colleagues Fernando Valencia and Christopher Scherer, we are the faculty who work with the students here in producing a percussion show. I get to talk because I've been here the longest, but we could not do it without this team of fine teachers, and so I did want to make sure that we recognize their contribution. We're going to start the show tonight with a marimba solo played by Thomas Baker. It's Casey Cangelosi's White Knuckle Stroll. Thomas is from Cullman, Alabama, and is a graduate student here, graduate of the University of North Alabama. Let's welcome Thomas to the stage.
Okay, this is the MUED 1371 class. This is our percussion methods class. And that means that these are mostly non-percussionists that are learning how to teach percussion for when they become music educators, mostly for when they become band directors. And this piece is called Trapdoor, mostly because it makes use of what we like to call trap tables. And so you'll see most of our students have either a music stand or an actually rolling designated trap table with either a carpet square or a towel on it to hold sticks, to hold instruments. And throughout the piece, you will see them pick things up, put things down quickly, hopefully quietly, hopefully without dropping things. We'll see how successful we are. One thing about this class is that we move really fast because we have a lot of things to cover. So we've maybe performed or rehearsed this piece, I think 4 class periods total, something like that. So not a lot, but we'll see what happens. So keep an eye out for all of the use of the trap tables, different instruments, different implements, and without further ado, here's Trapdoor.
Thank you. Hello. The next piece in the program is titled Edelma by Argentinian composer Tarik Tushi. Tarik Tushi wrote this tune and recorded in 1937. He was the executive director of RCA Victor Studios in New York. So one of his jobs was recording the broad spectrum of popular music back then, going from tangos from Argentina to tropical music from the Caribbean. But he particularly fell in love with the music that developed in the Andes in the center region of Colombia. And that music was typically developed and written through the vehicle of the Colombian string trio or quartet. We used to have guitar, tiple, and a bandola. So with this arrangement, I try to keep a little bit of those elements. Somehow the music for strings, for guitar especially, translates really well for marimba. And here is Edelma by Tarik Tushi. Hope you like it. Thank you.
One thing that's unique about a percussion ensemble concert is that if you're not careful, you end up moving more minutes than you end up playing. So we're going to try to be very efficient in moving from one piece to the next. I had the honor and pleasure of rehearsing Adelma a couple of times with this group while Professor Valencia was in Colombia presenting at the in Cartagena, presenting at the National Conservatory there. And what a delightful piece. I said, it's going to be everybody's favorite tune at this concert. By the way, Fernando Valencia will be conducting the Latin Jazz Ensemble on November 30th in the Union Theater. We've been kind of a traveling show here for the last year while they're working on the Fine Arts Concert Hall, Stella Boyle Smith Concert Hall. So we're ending up in odd places sometimes, Giffel's Auditorium, one place or another. Our next piece is very special to me. When I was a freshman at the University of Alabama as a business major, I was interested in getting some percussion lessons. They had a percussion teacher there who had just started named Larry Mathis, who went on to have a legendary career at the University of Alabama. And there weren't many percussion majors there. So when I went in and had a lesson with Larry, he said, hey, why don't you show up for this first orchestra rehearsal? We may need a timpanist for that. So I got to go in as a freshman and play timpani with the orchestra on Dvorak's New World Symphony, which has a big timpani part in. I was pretty happy to do that as the first week on campus. But also, he said, why don't you play in the percussion ensemble? And I said, what's that? And he explained it to me, and I said, that sounds like loads of fun. So we did, and that's where this piece particularly was a piece we rehearsed that year. And we had a Carlos Chavez festival in the spring of 1970 that he came in for. Chavez was approximately the same age as Aaron Copland. I believe he was born in 1906. Copland was born in, I think, 1900. And Copland actually traveled to Mexico, and they collaborated on things when Copland got the folk tunes that he used to write. El Salón México, his great orchestral work. It was working with Chavez that he did that. So both of those composers interacted with each other and learned a lot from each other. But while we had Chavez on campus, we actually got to perform this piece for him and have him make commentary, and then I got to play, I think Mr. Mathis played timpani, but I got to play bass drum on Chavez's El Sol, which is his great symphony, which has the loudest trombone playing in it I've ever heard, and at the insistence of Carlos Chavez. So this is the piece where I fell in love with percussion ensemble, fell in love with timpani playing, so it always has a special place in my heart. And I think they're about ready. They look it. Thank you. Well, this next group is the dictionary definition of chomping at the bit. They have been waiting for this, and I wish I could take any credit for what you're going to hear from the Alumni Percussion Ensemble, but other than making a few behind the scenes room getting and that sort of thing, it's all been them from the beginning. And it's a little bit of false advertising. It's an Alumni Percussion Ensemble, but one important member, Matt Briska, who's the percussion teacher for the Fayetteville Schools, is not technically an alumnus, but we claim him, and he gave us permission to go ahead and call it the Alumni Percussion Ensemble. It wasn't our intention to have it be an Alumni Percussion Ensemble, but it is. There are 18 degrees earned from the University of Arkansas in this stage, ranging from as recently as last spring to, Amy, 2001? You don't look a day over 27. So pretty good range in there. And they have, this is as small as it's going to get, I guess. You guys are doing a little bit of, you already had some contact, like, hey, how come I didn't get to be in it, that sort of thing. Yeah. So enjoy. This has been, I was so knocked out last night, just knocked out when they got it going. I couldn't have dreamed that this would be as important to me as it is. So guys, it's your show. Thank you. Well, Eustacio Morales needs to be grateful to Mr. Claire Omar Musser, who arranged that piece, because when you look up Mr. Morales, all you find is bolero in this arrangement for marimba ensemble. Of course, Mr. Musser, Mr. Musser was the grand old man of the marimba. He was born in 1900 and he lived 101 years. He died in whatever that would be, 2001. Organized 50 and 100 piece marimba bands. He was a maker of marimbas and a great promoter of the instrument. And he made a lot of money in his career, but he lost almost all of it. And at the end of his life, he was in a nursing home that wasn't really all that nice. But Joel Leach, who used to do arrangements for the Razorback Band and taught at Texas Tech University, was out at Cal State Northridge teaching there and found Mr. Musser and revived the music and made recordings that brought it back in popularity. He never left popularity. He's always been an important part of the instructional things in the marimba, but he's got his place cemented in history now. And you hate for somebody like that to be lost to forgottenness. For our next number, let me talk about Mr. Musser a little bit more. His wife was a travel agent, and so between the two of them, they would organize these 50-piece marimba bands.
Yeah. If you play on Crown of Thorns or the Rheinberger, you should be setting up right now.
I thought there was less activity up here than I was used to seeing. So. But I'm not going to have to get any jokes out or do any magic tricks, so this is going to be okay. As I was saying, Mr. Musser's wife was a travel agent, so they would organize these 50-piece marimba bands, 100-piece marimba bands, that would travel to, they played at the Chicago World's Fair, would that have been right, 1939? New York World's Fair. Chicago World's Fair was like 1893. But they played for the New York World's Fair in 1939 and also toured. There's a picture of them playing with 100 marimbas in what now is Bears Stadium in Chicago in what had to be, you know, minus 10 degree weather. But they were organizing these tours, and the deal on the tour was you had to buy a marimba. So by the time Mr. Musser sold 100 marimbas, and Mrs. Musser booked the passage, there was a little bit of money to be made, but they were famous for that. And if you've never heard 50 marimbas at once, and I bet you haven't, it's something to hear. For the 50th anniversary of the Percussive Arts Society, the society organized two 50-piece marimba bands, one of students and then one of professionals. I was honored to be one of the ones in the 50-piece professional, and I'd always wondered what that many marimbas on one stage moving that much air through that many resonator tubes would sound like, and it's unbelievable. And also the fact that they're all slightly out of tune just adds to the sense of immenseness. It really does. I always say a marimba's like a pizza. There's no such thing as a bad one. So anyway, that's about it on Mr. Musser. He actually played a concert here in Fayetteville that Jim Strain, the historian for the Percussive Arts Society and the person that wrote the percussion entry in the, what's the big music history dictionary book? What is that thing? You'll think of it. Just shout it out when you think of it. Anyway, he's been responsible as the historian of all things percussion. And he had come across a program of Mr. Musser playing here with the band and the orchestra. So we're trying to figure out what he played. There's a list of repertoire, and there was actually an article in the newspaper about it. This would have been about 1940. Well, our next number was, the program is a little bit incorrect. It says that Ben Wheeler from here in Fayetteville, who's a sophomore, is going to play Character Number 2 by Casey Cangelosi. But I noticed that this program was getting a little marimba heavy, so I went to Ben and said, hey, Ben, why don't we alleviate the the sameishness, and you play a really difficult, really challenging snare drum solo. So he picked one of the nine American French rudimental solos by Tompkins, Joseph Tompkins, who teaches at Rutgers. And to prove that he's actually keeping a beat, he's going to play the bass drum along with it. So come back on the 20, is it the 27th, everybody? I keep getting mixed up. 27th of November for our studio recital, and Ben will play character number two. But for tonight, he's going to regale us with his snare drumming. So Ben, take it away. Probably asking yourself a couple of questions about that. Was that as difficult as it sounds? The answer is yes. And did he play it as well as it seemed to? He did. That was good. Let's give him another hand. Ben Wheeler. To tell you about the next piece, we're going to bring out the arranger, Yoshio Yamashita. Yoshio graduated last spring with a degree in composition. Summa cum laude, I never get that right. The big one, summa cum laude, right. And then out of the Honors College, and now is working on his master's degree in conducting with us. So he will take it from here, and he's got some mallets for me as well.
So the next piece you're going to hear is Abendlied by Josef Rheinberger, who was a Bavarian composer from the late Romantic period. He lived from 1839 to 1901 and had contemporaries such as Johannes Brahms, and incidentally lived during the same time period as Gustav Mahler, though Mahler was significantly younger. Rheinberger was a talented organist, becoming his local church's organist at the age of 7, and having his first composition performed the next year at age 8. The first draft of this piece dates from 1855, when Rheinberger was 15 years old. It was later published as part of his Three Sacred Songs at age 24. It is perhaps one of his most performed works, and definitively the most performed of the Three Sacred Songs. And this version, of course, is for percussion ensemble instead of the original medium mixed chorus. Hope you enjoy Josef Rheinberger's Abendlied.
Our last number is by one of the great composers of percussion music. If there are classics in percussion music, then all of the music of David and Solanka would fall into that category of being something that, for me, I want to make sure that every generation of students who goes through here has the experience of hearing that music, hopefully playing it, but at least hearing it. And maybe if they're freshmen, when they get to be seniors, saying, hey, can we get Crown of Thorns out again and do that, because I didn't get to play the last time. Chavez Toccata being the same type of piece, it's a classic work. I ran into Ms. Lanka one time in Chicago at the Midwest. I didn't know it was Ms. Lanka. I was in line with him to check out and get my luggage to get on the shuttle to go to the airport. And I was behind a gentleman, and I tapped him on the shoulder, and I said, do you know, does anybody ever ask you if you, or tell you you look a lot like David and Ms. Lanka? And he said, well, I am David and Ms. Lanka. So I did the usual fanboy, oh, I love your music, play all your music. And Dale Warren and I get in the shuttle, and who's sitting there in the seat right in front of us but David Ms. Lanka. So we had an hour-long conversation with him that's among the highlights of my life. And after that, I felt comfortable. We've played most of his music, and I always felt comfortable emailing him and asking him about the piece and asking him for insights on it. And he was always very, very generous about that. He was not a religious person, but he was definitely a spiritual person. And so the title, Crown of Thorns, part of it refers to Christ's crown of thorns. But he also saw a plant called Crown of Thorns in Arizona. He was there, and the intricacy of it, the beautiful red flowers, reminded him of music. And his feeling is that there's so many things that transcend any certain religion that we all experience as human beings, music being one of them. So anyway, this is Crown of Thorns by David Ms. Lanka, and it should be known every 4 years by every percussion ensemble in the world.
Thank you.
There is a reception in the lobby. There's a story behind that. I should have told it already, so let's just go out and have some cookies and some social time. Thank you for coming out tonight.